We welcome each of you here today to celebrate with us on April the 26th, our live podcast. On a day where outside it seems rather gloomy, we just pray that the true sun shine upon you as you worship with us today by singing along with us, praying with us, listening to the Word of God, and then sharing in Holy Communion. Shall we open up with a word of prayer? Father, we come to you this morning, and we just thank you for the opportunity we have to worship you no matter where we are. Whether we're here in this sanctuary or whether we're in a home, Father, we just pray that you send your Holy Spirit to bring that place alive and to show the true Son of God in his miraculous form to each and every one of us. Bless our service now this morning, and we pray this in your name. Amen.
Yeah. Amen. As we remember Christ today, and we remember those who have gone to be with the Lord, and we remember those who are struggling at this time, I pray this song would touch your heart and bless you at this time. Heavenly Father, lead us this holy day to make every day holy before your throne of grace. Lord, as you remember us, may we remember you and all that we say and do, our prayers, our little acts of kindness. Teach us, Lord, your way of truth and your way of love. Amen. We're looking at growing down so that we can spiritually grow up in our faith. And so this morning I'd like to talk about growing down from complexity to simplicity. And when we think about the world today and everything that's going on, and even before this pandemic, our world has always been about complexity and busyness. You know, more activities, more priorities, more responsibilities. And our hearts get so full of clutter that we lose the beauty and simplicity of life. How many times have you heard somebody say to you, "Well, I'm just too busy"? Well, they could say things if they wanted to probably give an idea of what their life is like. They could say something like, "I'm busier than a one-eyed cat watching three mice holes." Or how about this? "I'm busier than a termite in a sawmill." Here's another one. "I'm busier than a hound chasing his tail in a storm." Here's my favorite. "I'm busier than a centipede at a toe counting contest." Have you been there? What has happened to that single-focused, simple life that Christ calls us to? Listen to God's word, Matthew 6, verses 22 and 23. Jesus says, "The eye is the lamp of the body." We're going to come back to that in just a moment. The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are good, your whole body will be full of light. What we focus on, what we perceive, what we're looking at has a way of defining who we are. But if your eyes are bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light within you is darkness, how great the darkness. See, Christ calls us in this message to an uncluttered heart and to have an undivided vision. And I have to be real here because I know my life and my heart has been cluttered up with so many things that it just chokes the life and simplicity out of me. That has been my story for way too long. A cluttered life lives at a hurried pace. I always have people, when they see me walking at a very high speed, "What's the hurry, Chris?" What's the hurry indeed? A cluttered heart lacks focus. You ever felt like you've been being pulled in 100 different directions? That our priorities are constantly divided and competing against each other, that you feel so stretched thin? See, this is what I believe. I believe that God wants to declutter our hearts so that He can fill it with His love, with His simple love. And there's always somebody that can say, "But Chris, you know, I've got to make the money. I've got business and family responsibilities. I've got appointments and duties." And yet that same person has to confess what? "But I'm frustrated. I'm exhausted by so many of the demands of life. No time to play. to pray, to have Sabbath, to rest, to have moments of silence, to spend time in wonder. See, true simplicity comes when you and I intentionally pursue it. I tell you what, since Sandy and I moved into this new house in Brownstown, I'm going to call her the clutter warrior. My wife has become the clutter warrior. And she has a complete action plan and to-do list that goes with it every single day. I know. I can attest to it. See, the only reason our home is uncluttered is because my wife takes an active stance against it being cluttered. And as Christians and believers in Christ, we too have to take an active stance against a cluttered heart. That Jesus here says the eye is the lamp of the body. That what we focus on truly is important. That he calls us to an undivided vision. And he says when our vision is divided, it becomes cloudy. It can even go dark. And it can get so dark that the darkness is greater than the light. And Jesus calls us to a single-minded focus. A simple vision. What is your focus? What are you looking at? Are you looking at the positive or the negative? Are you looking at the good or the bad? See, simplicity is to gaze with a single focus on Christ. That's what Scripture calls us to. That our focus is to be on Christ. That we're to realign our focus, our vision, on Jesus. Or we can just focus on the latest negative news on the television. See, if there's something I believe that God is wanting us to come together as a nation, as a people at this time in human history, it's this. That we need to catch a fresh glimpse of Jesus. So what do you see Christ doing in your life? What do you see Christ doing in the lives of others around you? Now many of you know that we've been praying for my new son-in-law, Justin. He has a coronavirus. And I praise God that he is getting better. And that's been a tremendous answer of prayer. But also during that time, my daughter had a pinched nerve in her neck. And if you've ever had a pinched nerve, you know how painful that is, and you also know that just doesn't magically go away. She couldn't go to the chiropractor because she was taking care of her sick husband. She was in quarantine, self-quarantine, couldn't go anywhere. And yet my family prayed the Lord to remove that pain in her neck, and she said just she woke up the next day and it was gone. What do you see God doing in your life or in the lives of those around you? Hebrews chapter 2 verse 1 talks about the danger of drifting. We can drift from our focus, we can drift from paying attention to the things that God calls us to pay attention to. And so in Hebrews 2:1, he says, pay attention all the more to what you have been taught so that you will not drift away. See, this is what happens in my life and your life. If you're not intentionally paying active attention, the writer of Hebrews says, you're going to drift. I'm going to drift. We're going to drift. Because the wind of the world is always pushing against us and not forward towards God in Christ. You say, well, you may want to cut down on your spending habits this year. But without intentionality, guess what? You'll drift. You may desire to eat healthier food this year, but without intentionality, you're going to drift. You may want to draw closer to God in these difficult times this year, but without intentionality, you will drift. See, complexity is reduced to simplicity in the presence of Jesus. Did you catch that? Complexity is reduced to simplicity in the presence of Jesus. I love that. You want to grow in God's Word? Set your alarm clock or your watch or your cell phone alarm to go off at that time that you need to be in the Word. You want to grow in love? Show acts of mercy and kindness. You want to believe that God's kingdom takes priority over the other priorities of this world? Then let your whole life be framed around a vision on Christ this season of life. Let me tell you how a vision of Christ can shape your life. There is a woman at Hoosier Christian Village, wonderful Christian lady. She just lost her younger brother to the coronavirus, 10 or 15 years younger than her. So I went to minister to her at this moment in her life. And what I discovered was that she ministered me. You know, as I began to talk to her, here's what she told me. She shared how Christ was with her brother through the whole ordeal when he was in the hospital. And now her little brother is in the big arms of his older brother, Jesus. Now that is the beauty and simplicity of faith in Christ. Amen. Order our hearts. Lead us into the way of Christ, where nothing would take us to the left or the right, but our focus would be just on you, O Lord, we pray. Amen. And amen.
Today's communion meditation comes from the book of John, chapter 6, beginning with verse 5 through 14. Very familiar story. It's often called Jesus' miracle of the feeding of 5,000. In this story, it's known to each and every one of us, a big crowd approaches Jesus after being marveled by his teachings. And out in the middle of nowhere, they find themselves with nothing to eat. At this critical time, Andrew, one of the disciples, finds a young boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish that he was willing to give up, that not only ended up feeding the multitude, but even having 12 baskets left over. In today's communion meditation, I really want to focus in on not Jesus' miracle in itself, but on the young boy who gave all that he had to God so that it could be blessed and used to feed others. You see, here at Bologna Christian Church, there's a modern day story of a boy who gave all that he had, and that God used it to feed each and every person spiritually. Some time back, Hunter Curry had 1 cell phone and 1 Facebook account. And while it may have seemed insignificant at the time, during this COVID virus, it's been God who used it as a miracle to feed each and every one of us spiritually. Not just the members of this church, but members throughout the United States that we see join in on each and every Sunday. So during this communion time, just ask that you meditate. Ask God, what possession is it that you have in your life that although may seem insignificant, yet he could use if you gave to him to perform a miracle in others' life. It may just be a kind word, a simple text to someone you care about. It might be a simple dollar that you can give to someone who's not working at this time and have financial needs. And it may even be a prayer. But whatever you find in your life that it could be, we just pray that you turn it over to God, that he could use it as a miracle to feed others' spiritual hunger. The Lord instituted the Holy Lord's Supper to remind us of the greatest miracle of all, the miracle of the perfect sacrifice to cover all of our sins. So on the night in which he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread, and he broke it, and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you." And after the same manner also, he took the cup, and after sup, saying, "This is the New Testament of my blood. Drink it in remembrance of me and for the remission of your sins." Father, we just pray during this communion time that we take a minute and look back on our lives and realize that you've given us each special gifts, things that we could use if we just turn them over to you, asking for you to do a miracle with those things so that we can help be a part of feeding someone's spiritual life. Father, we just pray this in your name, that like you created the great miracle of the forgiveness of our sins, that you create a great miracle with the gifts that you've given us, that once we submit them to you, can lead to the feeding of people's not only physical soul, but their spiritual soul. For this we pray in your name. Amen. I'd like to thank each and every one of you for joining us here today in our live service. Hope that each of you have been blessed as much as we have been blessed here during this time. And just ask that you join us again next week and share the good word with others about the opportunity to join us here during this time each and every week, even during this COVID crisis. Amen.